What are the various OSI layers? What are the various OSI layers?
Physical layer, data link layer, network.
Physical data link, network, transport.
Transport.
Presentation, application.
Okay. So, what are the protocols that application layer provides? What are the protocols that application layer provides?
HTTP, HTTPS, DNS, FTP, SMTP.
SNMP. SNMP, what else?
POP3, ma'am.
And Telnet. Telnet, all these are the protocols, okay, so that the application layer provides. Okay, can you tell me what is the responsibility of the presentation layer?
Presenting the data in the required format.
Encryption.
And for formatting, compression.
Formatting and transcription.
Okay. Translation means common encoding schemes, ma'am.
Okay.
Compression.
What is encryption?
Changing of data into other format, like somebody in the middle cannot understand what is the data.
Okay.
Only source and destination may be a code, ma'am. Purpose is to maintain the integrity of data.
Okay, good. What are the responsibility of the session layer?
Dialogue controller.
Synchronization.
Okay, what is dialogue control?
Two systems enter into a dialogue.
To organize the communication, ma'am. By offering half duplex and full duplex, ma'am.
Okay. It allows communication between two processes to take place in full duplex or in half duplex. What is synchronization?
Adding checkpoints or synchronization points.
Okay. What is a checkpoint? What is the purpose?
Acknowledging, ma'am, whether the system device B has received or not.
So checkpoints are used to make sure that the parts, okay, or the or you can say packets have reached successfully to the destination or not, so that resending of the corrupted data or the duplicate data or whatever is not sent again. Okay, so that's the purpose of the checkpoints or the synchronization point. Can anybody in the class tell me what is FTP stands for? FTP stands
file transfer protocol.
File transfer protocol.
What is HTTP? What is HTTP?
Hypertext transfer.
HTTPS.
Hypertext transfer protocol secure, ma'am.
Secure. Yes, good.
Secure.
Okay, so what is telnet?
Telecommunication
net. POP. Post office protocol.
Okay. SNMP.
Simple mail transfer protocol.
SNMP.
Simple network management.
Simple network management.
Okay. SMTP.
Simple mail transfer protocol.
Okay, good. Okay. So what is SSL? SSL.
Secure
socket layer.
It is secure socket layer, which is responsible for encrypting and all
encryption
of the data. Okay, so what happens at the session layer? So we saw that in the session layer, the dialog control happens and then the synchronization happens. So here you, for example, so let me just give you an example over here. So one system wants to say we have a system A, which is contacting the web server. So for example, there is a server here and it is requesting some data from the server. Okay, right. What happens is to transmit the data from this particular server to this particular device A, first the connection will be established, and after the connection is established, the images or the text or whatever is transmitted from the server to the device. Okay. So to actually transmit the data, what happens over here is other points that happens at the session layer is authentication. Okay. So what is authentication? Authentication means that whether who you are. Okay. So I just want to know like who you are. Like you need to give the username and the password to show who you are. That is what is called as authentication. Authentication confirms the person. Okay. So authentication confirms the person through the username and the password. So for example, your ECAP is there. So in your ECAP, other than the students and the faculty of this college, other people cannot, outsiders cannot use the ECAP, right? So to authenticate that it is you, you are the student of this college, you are given with an username, and you can set your own password for that. So that username and password will authenticate that it is you. Okay, so that also takes place in the session layer. Not only authenticating, so upon knowing who you are, authorizations are checked. For example, you are authenticated, you are a student, but you are not authorized to view the data of every student here, right? You can only see the information that is pertaining to you. So authorization is checked again. So all that things happen in the session layer. Okay. So after authenticating the device and user and also checking the authorizations, whether the person is can receive the data from the server, maybe it is having some textual information and some images and some videos and all that. So if the person is authorized to access that data only, then only the server will send the information to device A. If the person is not authorized to actually view the data, it will tell like you are not authorized to view the data. So all that things happen in the session layer. So the session layer will do dialog control, establishing connection between two devices and the transmission in full duplex or half duplex. And then it adds the synchronization points or the checkpoints to a stream of data. And then it does authentication and also it does authorizations. Okay, right. So that all that things happen in the session layer. Now we'll move on to the next layer below it, which is the transport layer. Now transport layer is responsible for many things. Okay, so you just need to remember all these points. Okay, so these are all the responsibilities of the transport layer: service point addressing, segmentation and reassembly, and connection control and flow control and error control. Now what happens is in the transport layer, the data is divided into segments. Okay, so segmentation happens here in the transport layer. So the transport layer is responsible for the process to process delivery. Now let me make it a point here by making you understand what is host to host communication and what is process to process communication. Host to host communication means that, for example, I am writing a letter to you. Okay, so I am writing a letter to one girl. Okay, say there is Priyanka over here. So what I'll do on the letter envelope, I'll write the address of Priya, right? I'll write the address of Priya and I'll send it to Priya. Now what happens, the letter will be delivered to the post box that is in front of Priya. Okay, so there can be many people, she is in a family, so there can be 5 or 6 persons in the house. Okay, so delivering to the mailbox of the house is called as host communication. Okay, so from device to device communication. So I want to transfer data from A to B to the computer of A, from the computer of A to the computer of B. This is like device to device communication or host to host communication. Okay, now what is meant by process to process communication or delivery? Process to process delivery means that on the destination device, so B is the destination device here, on the destination device there can be many applications running. Okay, so there can be many applications running. So this can be process one. Process is nothing but a program under execution. So a process is I gave you the definition here. A process is an application program running on the host. So there can be many processes that run on the device B. So to which process you want to give the data? So that is what is called as process to process delivery. I hope everybody understood. Host to host delivery means that it is from house to house or it is from device to device. So here I am sending the letter. The letter goes into the mailbox of the house. Okay. But there are so many people here. Priya's father is there, mother is there, brother is there, sister is there. But I am, so many people are there in the house, in this particular house. But I intended to send the letter only to Priya. So this is called as process to process communication. Okay, sending from one mailbox to another mailbox is host to host communication. So that analogy you can just apply over here. So communication between device to device is considered to be host to host delivery. And after doing the host to host delivery, you need to do the delivery to the process. Okay, so delivering to the process is done by the transport layer. So that's why it is called as process to process delivery. So these are very important points for your interviews and also for your MCQs, because like which layer is responsible for host to host communication and which layer is responsible for process to process delivery are some of the very, very important points. So the transport layer ensures that the whole message arrives intact and in order. So that's the responsibility again of the transport layer. And this layer breaks up the data from the sending host and then reassembles it in the receiver. Okay. So how it breaks up? Okay. So it breaks up the data, and each and every divided data is called as the segment. Okay. So segmentation is done here in the transport layer. Okay. And as I said, like service point addressing is nothing but the process to process communication delivery that I just talked about. So we have source to destination delivery. So delivery happens from one computer to another computer, but also we need to deliver it to the specific process that is running on the destination machine. So that is what is called a service point address, or the port address is added to establish this process to process communication. So that the port address is added by the transport layer in the segment. Okay, so what is the purpose of the port address? The port address will define the specific process. And so next is segmentation and reassemble. As I already told you that the message is divided into transmittable segments, where each and every segment will be having a sequence number in it. Okay, so here each and every number will be having sequence number. What is the purpose of the sequence number is because reassembly. Okay, so reassembly can be done because here we are dividing the packets. Okay, so you have divided the packets as U1. Okay, why you are giving 1 over here is meaning that it is the first packet, and then you are saying U2. So then again you have 2, which means that after 1, you need to put this particular packet. Okay, so the packets may be arrived in different order at the destination. So after the pack segments receive at the destination, the destination transport layer will reassemble all these packets based on the sequence number. Okay, so that's what will the transport layer do. assembling, reassembling, and then next is the connection orientation. So here the connection orientations are of two types here. Listen to me very carefully, ma. These are again there in your TCP/IP protocol. So this is very important. Connection control. The transport layer can be either connection-less or connection-oriented services. It gives connection-oriented or connection-less services. So that is the responsibility of the transport layer. Now, what is connection oriented transmission? Connection oriented transmission is given with the protocol which is TCP. TCP stands for Transmission Control Protocol, and TCP gives a connection oriented service. Okay, what is connection oriented service means that it establishes, makes a connection, the source transport layer makes a connection with the transport layer at the destination machine first. Okay, and after establishing the connection, only it will send the packets, and the packets are delivered. So such type of connection, transferring of the data, is called as connection oriented control. Okay, transmission. So what is connection less like, which treats it, the transport layer treats each and every segment as an independent packet, and then it will deliver it to the destination machine. So there won't be any connection established. It will just transport it, and it will just deliver to the destination. So that is transport, connection-less control, okay? So which is actually provided with the protocol, which is UDP. UDP stands for User Datagram Protocol. So the examples of connection oriented transmission is TCP, and an example of connection less transmission is called as UDP. So which is faster, TCP is faster or UDP is faster? And in the OSI, so it can provide connection control through TCP and UDP. Now which is faster? UDP is faster, okay, so than TCP. And UDP, but there is a disadvantage with UDP, User Datagram Protocol. UDP stands for User Datagram Protocol. There is a disadvantage with UDP, which is like UDP do not get feedback. Okay, so it doesn't get a feedback saying that whether the packet is delivered or not. Okay, and in TCP, it gets a feedback. Okay. And examples of TCP, in what situations you will be using TCP, connection oriented transmission, and in what situations you will be using UDP. TCP is used for emailing, okay, so for emailing, and also to for file transfer protocol and all that uses TCP kind of connection control. And for just video games and live streaming, online streaming and all that, UDP is used. Okay, so transport layer is responsible for connection control over here. And the next responsibility of the transport layer is the flow control. Okay, so what is flow control? Flow control is that end-to-end connection is established and the data is transmitted. For example, let me give, and the data is transmitted, which is like flow control. So end-to-end connection is established and the data is transmitted between the source to the destination. Now, what does it mean by that is called as flow, and what is control over here? Now, flow control means that, say for example, let me clear this out. Okay, say for example, there is a server, okay? So there is a server which is capable of, capable of sending more data, right? So say it is capable of sending 100 Mbps per megabits per second, okay? And we are having a mobile phone over here. So this is the mobile phone, and the mobile phone's capacity is only 10 Mbps, okay? So say that the server is capacity is 100 Mbps, and uh, okay, and the mobile's capacity is 10 Mbps, okay, and you're requesting something from the server, and the server is sending the data back to the mobile, but there is no sync between the capacity, the transmission rate, and the receiving rate over here. So what happens is the data will get, the mobile phone will be overwhelmed with the data that is coming from the server. So this will be overwhelmed, and so a lot of data gets accumulated here, resulting in the data loss. So what the transport layer does over here is, now the transport layer comes into the picture, and what it does is it communicates with the transport layer of the server, stating that my capacity is 10 Mbps, please reduce the transmission rate and send it in sync with the transmission receiving rate of the mobile. So then what happens is the server will slow down, sending 10 Mbps or 15 Mbps per second, okay, I mean megabits per second. So the transport layer will tell the server to actually slow down. And not only telling it to slow down, in case the server, so many devices are connected to the server and the server performance have dropped down, and the server is able to send only 5 Mbps per megabits per second. And but your mobile phone can receive 10 megabits per second. So now what happens is the transmission is again not in sync. Okay, so the receiving capability is more, whereas the transmitting capability is less. Now again, the transport layer will again tell the server to increase the speed and send it in a pace that the receiver receives. So all that concept is called as flow control. Okay, and the other responsibility of the transport layer is the error control. So what is error control? Error control is, for example, okay, again, we are looking into the device A and B. So I transmitted certain packets from A to B. Now what happened is during the transit, the data is lost. Okay, so the data is lost because many reasons can be there for the data being lost. So the data is lost, or now what happened is the data arrived in a corrupted manner, okay, and so all these are considered to be errors, okay, and the transport layer is responsible to see to it that all the data is arriving. So you can just observe this point that I have put up here, so which means that the transport layer ensures that the whole message arrives intact and in order. So what happens is, for example, I'm sending packet 1, 2, 3 to from the source to the destination, but the destination received only 1 and 3. Okay, so the 2 is not here. So while putting it in order, so it will check like what are the packets that didn't arrive. So now the transport layer is responsible. So the transport layer will automatically initiate a message to the transport layer of the sender, okay, so which is called as ARR. ARR is a protocol which is automatic repeat request. So the transport layer will issue an ARR. ARR is automatic repeat request. So the requesting the transport layer of the sender to resend the packet to. Okay, so now what happens is the source will repeat or send the packet again back to the destination. So the packet which is missing, okay, so the data packet which is missing, so the transport layer is responsible in looking into it that all the packets are arrived and they are in order. And if any one of the packet is lost during the transit, then the transport layer will issue an ARR to the source, and the source will resend the packet. Okay, so meanwhile, what can happen is there can be a duplicated data that is arrived. Maybe it is late in the middle. Somewhere around there is a congestion. Congestion is a traffic jam like thing that can happen even in the network. So in case if there is some congestion and the packet arrived late, so it has issued an ARR to the source and the packet arrived. Okay, so now what happens, it will receive 2 copies of the same data. Okay, so which is the packet which has arrived late and also the packet which is tasked to send it again. So now duplicate data has arrived at the destination. So the transport layer is responsible for removing all the duplicates and all that. So the transport layer will do the error control. So these are all the responsibilities of the transport layer. The first one is service point addressing. As I told you, like, it is process to process communication. To establish the process to process communication, it will insert a port number. So port number will identify the process, and then it divides the data that it received from the session layer into segments. So segmentation is done at the session layer, at the transport layer. So to each and every segment, it will add a sequence number so that at the destination, the packets can be reordered and reassembled. Okay, right. So that happens as the second responsibility of the transport layer. And the next comes the connection control. The connection control is done in two ways. The first one is TCP, which is connection-oriented transmission, and the second one is UDP. UDP stands for User Datagram Protocol. TCP stands for Transmission Control Protocol. So Transmission Control Protocol is connection-oriented, and connection-less is UDP. Examples of UDP is like online streaming and video gaming, all that is done by establishing a connection-less transmission. And connected oriented service is established by sending emails, for sending messages from one person to another, and also for file transfer, TCP is required. Okay, so this is regarding the connection control. And next, coming to the flow control, as I already told you, transport layer is responsible for flow control between the source and the destination. So if server or any other machine is transmitting at a higher rate, it will tell it to slow down, and if it is not matching, if it is not in sync, it will tell it. Okay, right. So that happens at the flow control of the transport layer. And error control is where in case there is a missing packet, then the destination transport layer at the destination will inform the source to resend the packet. Okay, right. So this kind of error correction, okay, so the error correction is established by retransmission of the data. And the error can be like, it can be a damage. So what can be the error? Okay, so errors can be like damage of the packet, or it can be loss of the packet, or it can be duplication of the packet. All these are considered to be error. And all these are rectified by retransmission of the packets. So this is all that happens at the transport layer. So the segment that is at the transport layer now goes down to the network layer. So now we'll see what will happen to the segment that is taken by the network layer. So at the transport layer, so the data unit is a segment, okay? So at the transport layer, so what is the data unit at the transport layer? And at the transport layer, the data unit is the segment. Now the segment has arrived at the network layer, and the segment that has arrived at the network layer, what it will do is, it will put it, add its own header, and now it will make a new packet, and the name of the new data packet is nothing but a packet. Okay, so the data unit over here in the network layer is considered to be a packet. You call the data unit as a packet in the network layer. What is the data unit at the transport layer? The data unit at the transport layer is a segment. Okay, so you call this as a segment over here. So let us look into what happens in the network layer. So in the network layer, so I hope all of you are following me. Clear or not?
Yes, ma'am.
Clear. Okay, clear. Okay, so now coming to the network layer. So as I already told you, the data unit over here is a packet. So the network layer will add a header to the segment that it has received from the transport layer. And the new envelope now is called as a packet here. Okay, so these are your MCQs. What is the data unit at the transport layer called as? The data unit at the network layer called as the data unit at the data link layer called as. So all these are frame. It is called as a frame in the data link layer. So all these are your MCQs. Okay, fine. So if two systems are connected to the same link, then there is no need for the network layer. So this is a very important point I am trying to discuss. Now what happens is, if there is communication between the two devices in the same LAN, okay, so then there is no need for the network layer. So the network layer will be needed only if there are two LANs. Okay, so I have one LAN here and I have another LAN here, and there is a communication from the device. This LAN is having the device B, and this LAN is having a device A, and A device from LAN 1. Okay, so this is LAN 1 and this is LAN 2. And this LAN is located in some part, okay, say Bhimavaram, and this LAN is located in, say, in Saudi Arabia or whatever. And there are two devices. So I have a device A in LAN 1 and device B in LAN 2. And these two wants to communicate. So to establish the communication between these two devices, which are in two different networks, okay, so then you need a network layer. If the destination and source are in the same LAN, okay, so say A is here and say there is B1 here, and A wants to communicate to B1, then there is no need for the network layer. Am I clear, Ma? Am I clear with this point?
Yes.
Okay, fine. And responsible for source to destination delivery of a packet across multiple networks. Now the network layer will be having an IP address. So to make you understand the responsibilities of why I said, like, if there are two networks, okay, so this is network one and this is network two, why I said that, you will understand. Okay, so this is network one, say for example this is LAN one and this is LAN two, and they both are connected via a satellite, say that there is a satellite link here, and these two are connected like this, and the device A in this particular network wants to communicate with the device in this particular network. Then you require an network layer, you require the network layer, and you also require another addressing which is called as an IP addressing. Okay, so you require an IP address. I already showed you, like, what is an IP address. Say I am communicating to you, right? So even if to connect to MS Teams and talk to you, make a live stream communication to you, I need an internet. I need internet to actually connect to you, because you people are located in different locations, and you people are connected to different networks. Okay, I am connected to a different LAN and different connection, and you people are there. Now, how do you think that the traffic, the data that I am speaking over here in this particular LAN is reaching you? It is reaching you via a router. Okay, so there will be a router here in the network, and as I already told you, the router is a networking device which is responsible for identifying the IP address. IP stands for Internet Working Protocol, so it is also called as Internet Protocol, or you can also say that it is an Internet Work Protocol. So IP protocol is responsible for giving a logical address to each and every machine, and the logical address can be given in terms of IPv4 or IPv6. So there are different addressing schemes of Internet Protocol. So the addressing scheme that we are using is IPv4, and slowly it is moving on to IPv6. The difference between IPv4 and IPv6 is nothing but because the number of addresses that IPv4 is providing is exhausting. Okay, so for example, if the addressing of IP is only 2 bits, ankundam. For example, if the addressing of the IP is only 2 bits, so how many addresses can this can be possible, Andy? And say that there are only 2 digits to represent an IP address, which is 1 and 0, and so there are it can be represented only in 2 bits, that is 1 and 0. And how many addresses you can give? I can give only 4 addresses, right? 0, 0, and 0, 1, and 1, 0, and 1, 1. So I can give only 4 addresses, meaning that only 4 computers can be, because IP address will be unique from system to system. Okay, so each and every device that is connecting to internet will have its own IP address. Now, there will be only four addresses possible. Okay, so IPv4 addresses are not sufficient now for the entire world, because each and every device will have its own IP address. So that's why they have increased the number of bits, and they have created a new version of IP, which is version 6, which is having more number of addresses in it. So slowly we are moving from IPv4 addressing to IPv6. So this address, giving the logical addressing and all that, is the responsibility of the network layer. Say for example, that's the first responsibility of the network layer. So the physical addressing is implemented, like the physical address is the MAC address, the MAC address is the address given by the manufacturer, so which will be there in your NIC card, network interface card. So that will identify a device, but logical addressing is needed. Okay, so that physical address will not be known to your router and all that. So the in the internet, a system is identified only with the logical addressing, and the logical address is nothing but internet protocol version 4 addresses. Okay, and if a packet passes in the network, okay, so from one network to another network, so the boundary, okay, so as it passes out of this particular boundary, it needs to pass only through a router, okay, so it needs to pass, so this is a LAN. As long as the data is inside this particular LAN, there is no need for a router for you, okay, so if there is a hub or a switch, it will work. But if you want to transmit it outside the LAN, okay, so you want to send it into an internet, so then you require a router over here, and this router will be able to identify the IP address. So based on the destination's IP address, it will route the packet. Okay, there can be many networks connected. So say it is connected to two networks, there are three networks over here. So the device is here. So what happens is, based on the IP address of this particular destination, because inside the data packet that we are talking about in the network layer, so the packet we talked about over here in the network layer, so there will be the source address and the destination address. And so the source address and the destination address I'm talking about is the IP address. So based on the IP address, it routes the packet in this direction. So it sends the packet to this particular network. Now, there is another question that comes in your mind over here now. Okay, but first thing is, it need to identify the network, and then it need to identify the device. So first thing is, it need to identify the network. So the routing should happen to the network, wherein this network again will be having a router here, which will do the trafficking of the data that comes from this particular network. So each and every network will be having a router only. So the data goes in and comes out from that particular network only through the router. So the router is responsible to send the packets into the network, and the router is responsible for bringing in the packets into the network. So everything has to pass through this particular gateway, which is the router. So now, first thing I need to observe is, like, just take a look at this particular diagram. So I said this is LAN 1. And this is some other network. So this is some LAN 2, and this is LAN 3 and LAN 4. First thing is, I need to identify the network to which I need to send. So to identify the network, we do have a concept which is called as mask. Okay, so the mask will identify the network. And so say for example, the mask is, while sending, the mask is 225.225. So this looks like an IP address. So 225. So you might have seen this then again 225.0. Okay. So there will be four combination of numbers here. The first three combinations will identify the network. And so this is the mask. So the first three combinations will identify the, we'll discuss this mask and all in the later classes, but just as of now, understand that network layer works when there is two or more networks connected together, and you want to send the data from one network to another network, then the network layer is used. And the responsibility of the network layer is to give the logical addressing. So in the packet that it creates, it includes the IP address of the source and also the IP address of the destination. And then it is routed via the router. Now the router will actually do the routing. Okay, so I said here it is doing the routing over here. Routing is like in which direction I have to send the packet. So how it does the routing or routing over here is, it will so to do the routing we require a router. And so this is again an MCQ. What is the networking device that is required, connecting device or the networking device that is required for routing? So for routing you require a router. So how this router will identify that the packet is intended for this particular network is because with the mask. Okay, say for example the IP address of the destination is 192.157.3.1 or whatever. So again there will be four combination of numbers. So the thing is, like for example I'm saying 192 dot some number, okay, so 160 dot or something like this. So I have 3.1 and all that. So this is the IP address of, this is IP version 4, and the IP version 4 address looks like this. I already showed you the IP address in the first class. Do you remember the IP address? So I showed you like what is the IP address of my machine and all that. You can also check the IP address of your mobile phone. In your mobile phone, you can Google and type in what is my IP address. It will give you your IP address. So each and every device, so you will be having an IP address. If you are listening to me, you are connected to me through an internet, then definitely you will be having an IP address. So that's the reason, like even if you think like I am sitting in a room and I am commenting somebody, based on your IP address you will be caught. So again, the most of the crimes, like people don't know that there will be an IP address. And each and every device can be identified with an IP address. They do not know that. So most of the people think that we are in a closed room, nobody is watching us. So they do a lot of cyber crimes sitting in a room, sitting that nobody is watching. But each and every, your ISP, your internet service provider knows everything that you are doing. Whatever websites you are opening, whatever, if this internet service provider, if we give he is the one who is responsible in giving you an IP address. So even if you think that nobody knows like what I'm browsing, it is a myth. Like your internet service provider knows everything. He will be having the history of, even if you delete the history in your phone, but your phone or your computer, the ISP will know it. The internet service provider will know like what is the traffic, what are the websites, or what is the data that you are browsing through. So nothing is hidden, and so everything is in public. Only thing is you are sitting in a room, that's it. Okay, but everything is public. So many people think that connecting to an internet and sitting in a room, that nobody will know. Everybody will know. Like this, the police goes to the internet service provider and gets like what is the IP address, and then extract everything. So it will be, all the things will be out. So IP address is the one like through which you connect to the internet. So each and every device will be connected with an IP address. So the routing, first thing is the network is identified. How the network is identified? The network is identified through a mask, wherein the first three combinations when applied to this particular IP address will give the network address. So first thing is the data will be sent to the network. In this particular network, so the router that is here will receive the packet, okay? And then this particular router will be responsible to send it to the device in its network. So that all these things will happen in the network layer. And next is path determination. So what is path determination?
Ma'am?
Yes.
Ma'am, some of us are having CNDA class, ma'am. Can you please permit us to attend?
Yeah, you can go, ma'am.
Thank you, ma'am.
Okay, so the next one is, the next point is the path determination. So what is path determination? Path determination is sending the packets through a specific path. So here we do have certain algorithms. We do have certain algorithms which will actually choose the shortest path and all that. So for the path determination is nothing but sending the packet in a specific path. Like we choose paths, right? If you're going from one place to another, the first thing you do is, like, if you want to go from Bhimavaram to Vijayawada, the first thing you do is you look into what is the shortest path in terms of kilometers, the shortest path in terms of kilometers. Then you will see, like, whether the roads are good or not, or whether it is convenient for the car to go in that particular direction or not. So all that you will be looking into. So a path is determined, okay, for routing the packets, and there are specific algorithms for doing the path determination or path identification, and those algorithms are OSPF. What is OSPF? Open shortest path first. Okay, so this is one of the path determination algorithms. So which is open shortest path first, and then you also have another algorithm which is BGP. What is BGP stands for? BGP stands for Broad Gateway Protocol. So this is again another routing protocol. And another one is Intermediate Systems, which is IS and IS. IS and a dash over here, and then an IS. So which is again a routing protocol. So these protocols are used to determine the path in which the packet should transmit. So I'll stop my class over here with the network layer. In tomorrow's class, we'll discuss more on the data link layer and the physical layer.